Kaye navacha manasyendrayerva bhutyatmanava prakrite swabhava karomi adyat sakalam paresma narayanayeti samarpayami. Narayanayeti Samarpayami.
Dear Seeker of Truth, welcome. In this series of videos, we are going to talk about Bhakti Yoga, the path of devotion, of divine love, of God realization. So we are going to talk about the Narada Bhakti Sutras, a beautiful work attributed to sage Narada that talks about in full length of the path of devotion. May you all find inspiration in this work. May you all find meaning and purpose in your spiritual quest through these words. This kind of work, these words, these sutras, they bring light and they open the door to the life of the real quest for liberation. May you also find divine love in your heart. Moving on the Narada Bhakti Sutras, chapter 5, verse 20. There are such instances. So it is, so it is. So the next sutra, this sutra says that there are certain instances like this, of this kind of devotion. The next sutra will illustrate Narada's point. So Sutra 21, as for instance, in the case of the cow maids of Vraja and Vrindavan. So from all the devotees, Narada chose the illiterate, simple cow maids as the example of the highest devotion. And in their highest devotion, there's a component which is worth mentioning, which is self-surrender. And without self-surrender, it is not yet pure devotion. It cannot be. Self-surrender is that which ultimates, purifies devotion. Without it, all devotion that you are turning towards God is coming back to your desires, and God remains as a means for it, not as an end. So Narada brings the example of the highest devotion of the cow maids of Vrindavan, those that lived with Krishna, so let's go to some points which are important. They played with Sri Krishna and identified themselves with him in complete devotion. So they had risen to the level of Sri Krishna, fully identifying with him, removing all the differences through their devotion, through the purity of their devotion and self-surrender. They didn't care of family tradition, reputation, and personal comfort in order to live person devotion, perfect devotion to Lord Krishna. So they risked all, not caring about what family would say, what are the family protocols, and all of this. They just wanted to be with Krishna all the time. And that in India would do harm to the reputation, and they were not interested in their reputation. And also, these are very important points, because they speak about things that are important and need to be transcended. So the need for comfort, the need for that image which people invest in creating so that it will bring in an easier way that which they desire. All of this has to be put at risk in a serious spiritual path, or else you're just moving inside your own cage. So many times, as you're trying to move into the direction of real devotion, of real spirituality, you are placed in the middle of this crossroad, maintaining your image, your preferred image. In this case, it is talking about reputation. It can be something else. And your personal comforts, or leaving them behind so that you can live with a saint, a sage. In this case, it was Krishna. Or to dedicate yourself fully to a devotional life. So it will be very difficult to find this in the comforts of your home. And this is where choices arise, and this is where steps are given or not. But in the case of the gopis, they were the highest ideal of devotees, because when facing this, it was not even a choice. Their heart wanted to be with Krishna only, and they knew who Krishna was. They knew he was not a man. They said, "Wherever we look, we find Shyam," which is another name for Krishna. "In the dark rain cloud, in the black pupil of our eyes, in the dark tamal leaves, in the blue waters of Yamuna, in the blue sky, etc." Their level of devotion was so intense that they would see their beloved everywhere they look. And this is a revelation that only pure devotion can bring. It is not exaggeration. Pure divine love removes all inequalities and brings the lover and the beloved on the same level, divine. It results on the fusions of personalities. So this is a principle that it is quite well observed among couples that love each other and spend a lifetime together. You look at one, you look at the other, even their faces are similar. This is that love, that proximity that brings. So the same in this divine love, there is a fusion of personalities. So the old selves disappear. And it's not that God comes to your level, you go to God's level. If self-surrender is there, of course, if it is a part of your devotion, if your devotion is based on self-surrender. The gopis were the crest jewel among the devotees of the Lord. The love of the gopis cannot be adequately described in words, because it was a much above words, above the mind. It's something that transcends the mind. So it can be spoken of, but not at that level, not to that extent. They dedicated their bodies, their minds, possessions, souls, and their all to the Lord. And in a way, being close to God in the way they were, in the presence of a God's incarnation, it was an opportunity. And well, there's many opportunities, similar or whatever. to surrender your all in all. And these things are important. And in a way, when it is serious, they will come in some way or another. Of all spiritual disciplines, including bhakti, self-surrender is I will read that sentence again. They dedicated their bodies, their minds, possessions, souls, and their all to the Lord. They weren't concerned about what they would look like, what people would think about them, if they had comforts or not. They knew who he was. They didn't care about those things. They surrendered all to him. Everything was his. They always sang the Lord's glories with their voice choked with emotion. So this is a sign of pure devotion, of intense devotion, when the voice gets choked by it. And this is how they were always constantly singing the praises of the Lord. Lord Krishna spoke to them. You have cut all domestic ties for my sake. I cannot repay the debt of yours by serving you, even for a lifetime of a celestial being. Please relieve me from that liability out of your own generosity. And this is very beautiful because God's Dharma is the Dharma of love, and pure love brings God from whatever he is to the presence of the devotee. It's almost like pure love can make God a slave. He is a slave to love, to pure love, not whims and fantasies. So this is why Krishna told them, I cannot repay that debt. There was a debt, so please, out of your compassion, relieve me of that. This is very beautiful and very accurate. The Lord says, the gopis have given themselves up to me, their heart and soul. They think that I am their life. They have abandoned all their closest relatives for my sake. I always support those who cast aside all worldly pleasures for my sake. Those are the real devotees. And the Lord always takes care of them. Always. These are, you can see in this line, these are the highest sacrifices. The highest sacrifices. And this is why they are the example brought by Narada. But continuing. The gopis surrendered all their actions at the lotus feet of the Lord Krishna. They experienced acute agony if they missed his presence even for a moment. And this is very important. Their state of devotion, if they missed it even for a moment of his presence, they would experience acute agony. And how exalted souls were they that till this day they are being spoken of? They are being used as an example for all the seekers that are coming behind them through all those generations. When they heard the sweet melodious flute of their beloved, they left their houses while milking the cows. Milking the cows, serving dinner, washing the plates, whatever they were would do by just by listening to the flute of Shri Krishna, they would abandon everything and rush towards him. With mind absorbed in Krishna, they rushed forth to where their lover was without taking notice of each other. They would not even realize each other around themselves. So that was the extent of their focus and devotion, of their absorption in Krishna. Some did not see the boiling of the milk, did not wait to see the boiling of the milk. Some did not take the food out of the oven. Some were serving their husbands, others were taking food, and all would leave their work without finishing. Sutra 22. Even there, the love of the gopis, there is no particular reason for forgetting the glory and greatness of the Lord. This is a very important point. An incarnation of God could easily be mistaken by these women that had a worldly life, a common life, to mistaken him as a man. But they didn't. They always knew who he was. So devotion to God is devotion to God, and it's supposed to rise you above worldly consciousness. But many times, in many cases, what was done, and we see this in many stories, eventually God would be looked upon as a family member, a friend, a foe, or whatever. And for devotion to rise, to purify, you must always remember that it is God. So without a clear consciousness of the majesty and grandeur of God, devotion cannot operate as a persistent factor of human development. This speaks about what I've mentioned, and your mind is always playing tricks on you, always. So either in devotion, you are devoting yourself because of your desires, so without self-surrender and using all opportunities that are many, that come to you, to accept God as the hand behind all of them and to surrender continuously. And to know that it is God. And looking above towards God that will elevate you. Or else you'll continue to try to pull things to your level and get no benefit out of it. Because no real devotion will come, no purity will rise. The gopis danced in the moonlight and played with Shri Krishna. For those who know the story, those who don't know, eventually you will find those stories. And yet they were not unconscious of his divinity, his omnipresence, of his omnipotence, even for a second. They recognize him as the soul of the universe and also as their own Atman. And his presence there was a present that he gave them to spend all those years close to them so that they could live that love in that condition. This is a priceless gift. And this is priceless because of God's presence. This is important to underline, because many devotees as they get, if they would get the opportunity to be in the presence of God in an incarnation, they would use that to get personal favors, to ask for something, to, but that's the ultimate opportunity to surrender and to live that love. The gopis surrender to Krishna, knowing to be God himself and the embodiment of Satchit-Ananda. They were not scholars, they were not learned ones, they had a pure heart. So for certain spiritual disciplines, you need to have other qualifications. But that's usually in the absence of a pure heart. Pure heart is the highest qualifications. It doesn't need a very sharp intellect or any of this. A pure heart is the highest. And many times, other spiritual paths that you need to have a strong mind and all of this, other qualifications, it's because the heart is not pure. And it is a way to purify the heart. Because the heart is the real eyes of the seeker. It's that, it's the vision. They said, the gopis, you are the primal Purusha or Purushottam, the protector of the devas. You are the witness of everything. You have taken an incarnation for the protection of the whole world. This was their understanding. And all time they spent with Krishna, they delighted in that supreme love. Okay.
Tvameva mata chapita tvameva tvameva bandushka saka tvameva Tvameva vidya dravinam tvameva tvameva sarvam mama deva deva tvameva sarvam mama deva deva.